This video is brought to you by Squarespace.
Hi everyone. What? I was just taking a break. Welcome to the part 2 of my Ansible home server series. In this series, we will go from zero to writing a fully featured infrastructure as code for your home server based on Ubuntu server. In this video, we will expand our playbook by using roles, learn about handlers and loops, and also learn about how to import other people's roles and use them in your playbook. In the first part of the series, we have created a super basic playbook for the initial setup of a Linux server. It gives our user passwordless pseudo privileges, updates our system, installs some packages, and hardens the SSH access. As you can see, it's not a lot. But as your playbook grows, you're gonna want to separate your tasks into different sections to keep it neater. This is where roles come into play. Roles are basically mini playbooks. They can have their own variables, tasks, and handlers. At the same time, they also inherit the playbook variables, so they're not completely isolated from the rest of the playbook. You can think of them as modules in Python. Let's create our first role by creating a folder called roles. And then let's create another folder here called system. That's gonna be the name of our role. Then we need to create a folder named tasks. And in this folder, we're going to create a file called main.yml. Personally, I usually separate the role tasks into different files and then use the main file to concatenate them. This is what it would normally look like. I have separated our tasks into three files, user.yml, ssh.yml, and essential.yml. And then I have the main.yml file, which includes all three of these files. One more thing that you should add to your role is a defaults file. Your role will probably use some variables, and as you can see, mine does too. We have defined our variables in our group vars file here in the previous episode, but if we remove them, our playbook will actually fail. So in order to make our role a bit more portable and self-contained, we're going to add defaults for all the variables referenced in it. As your role expands, eventually you might want to use it in your other projects, or even share it with other people so that they can use it in theirs. For now, there's only two variables called packages and username, so I'm just going to copy them from the group vars and paste them here. Now we also need to edit our playbook file to include the role and not the tasks, like so, and we're done. No, I'm just kidding, we're not. Our role needs to do more stuff. And the first thing that I'm going to add is a task that manages our non-root user. For that, we're going to use the module called user, set the name of our user to a variable called username, and then set the password to a variable called password. However, to make things more secure, we're also going to hash our password by using a password hash filter. Filters in Ansible are similar to pipes in Bash, and are used to transform variables. There are filters that can turn your variable into lowercase or uppercase, for example, and the password hash filter basically hashes our password and ensures that the password isn't stored in clear text on our target machine. Here's another, more complex example of using a filter. Let's say we have a variable with our home network subnet, 192.168.1.0/24. And let's say we want to create another variable with the static IP of our home server. Now we can always just hardcode our subnet everywhere, but that would be a real pain in the butt if that subnet ever changes, plus DRY. So instead we can use a regex replace filter to remove the last bit of our subnet, save it into a separate variable, and then use this variable whenever we need to describe an IP in our subnet. This is what all three variables look like. Then we'll set our groups. We want our user to have sudo privileges, so let's add him to the group called sudo. We also want him to be able to access Docker, and then we'll also add him to a group called users. After that, we're going to set append to yes, so that Ansible doesn't create the user from scratch every time you execute the playbook, and then also set our login shell to a variable called shell. And finally, set update underscore password to on underscore create. Since we're using a password hash instead of a clear text password, Ansible will regenerate the hash on every run, and as a result, the task will always be marked as changed, even if there are no changes being made. This basically makes it so that the password is only set when the user is initially created. But if you change your password often and don't mind sacrificing some item potency, feel free to omit this setting. We've used two additional variables here, password and shell, so let's add them to our defaults. Then add our shell variable to group vars, and then add our password to our vault file. If your password is super secure and only consists of numbers, just like mine, make sure to put it in quotes. Otherwise, Ansible will interpret it as a number. As you can see, we've added our user to a group called Docker. The problem is that the Docker group is only created after installing Docker, and if the group doesn't exist yet when we're running the task, we're going to get an error. So we're going to fix that and also learn about loops. Let's create a new task before the one that creates our user. We're going to use a module called group, and then set the name of the group to item, wrapped in two curly braces and quotation marks. Then at the same indentation level as group, we're going to write loop. And in here we can put all of the groups that we want to be created. So for instance, Docker, Samba, and the self-titled group for our username. Normally the latter should already be created with the user, but in some distros that doesn't happen for some reason. This is basically going to iterate through the list and execute the task for every list element. The keen-eyed among you might have noticed that with some Ansible modules like package, you can write a list of packages right here in the name parameter without having to do a loop. And yeah, unfortunately this is not super consistent, so the best way to find out which modules support that and which don't is basically trial and error. As you can see, when we try to pass a list to our group module, our playbook fails. Now we're going to create another task to suppress the login message, which is this wall of text. For that we're going to use a module called file. File can be used to manipulate files and folders. Basically, it creates a file, deletes a file, changes permissions, and so on. In our case, we're going to create the file called .hushlogin in our user's home directory. Now this part might seem a bit excessive, but setting permissions and ownerships for files that you manage with the file module is a good practice. And if you have Ansible lint installed, it's actually going to complain if you don't do it, as you can see. I mean, sure, having unsafe permissions on a hushlogin file is probably not going to be that big of a deal, but you will eventually need to manage other files, and it's good to do stuff right from the very beginning. We're also going to set both modification time and access time to preserve. This will ensure that the task isn't unnecessarily marked as changed, since we only really care about putting the file in there and not when it was changed or accessed. And state touch works the same way as touch does in the Unix command line. If the file isn't there, it's going to create it, and if it is there, it would normally update its modification and access times, but in our case it's actually not going to do anything because of these two lines. Now let's move on to SSH. Remember that SSH task that we wrote that disables password authentication? There is also a task after it that restarts the SSH daemon if the previous task actually changed the config. Well, there's actually a better way to do it, and it's called a handler. Let's create a folder called handlers in the role folder, and then create a file called main.yml. Let's copy-paste our task that restarts SSHD, and then remove this line. Instead, we're going to go back to the task file and replace this line that starts with register with notify, colon, and then the exact name of the handler. What this is going to do is basically call the handler anytime the task changes stuff. It's pretty much the same as what we had, but according to Ansible, this is the right way to do it. Usually, the handlers will be executed at the end of the playbook, but we can also force the handler execution by using meta flush handlers. Since our Ansible playbook runs over SSH though, restarting it at the very end is probably the right call. I also want to show you some more ways to use loops. And for that example, I'll use a task that I shamelessly stole from Jeff Geerling's security role. Jeff is an absolute legend when it comes to Ansible stuff, be that books, tutorials, roles, or other things. And we're actually going to return to one of his roles later on in this tutorial. For now though, I'm going to paste this task into a role, change a few things, and tell you what it does. Basically, it loops over a list of dictionaries, and each of these dictionaries includes a variable called line and a variable called regexp. We can then refer to those variables with item.line and item.regexp respectively. We're also using the validate parameter to save our configuration file in a temporary location and let SSHD verify its syntax before actually moving it permanently. That can potentially save us from being locked out of SSH in case we messed up the SSHD configuration file. That's going to be enough for our system role for today, and now let's move on to Docker. Now, I use Docker for running pretty much all of my services. And if you're watching this video, chances are you also want to have a similar setup. As you write more and more Ansible roles, you'll notice that a lot of the things that you write are kind of repetitive. At some point, you might even think, surely somebody way smarter than me has done this before. And in most cases, the answer is yes, they have. Ansible includes a utility called Ansible Galaxy, which gives you access to a community repository of roles. Unless you're dealing with a super specific use case or a very obscure piece of software, chances are there's already an Ansible role for it. Now, seeing the quality and the quantity of roles from reputable Ansible devs like Jeff, it might be tempting to only use other people's roles in your playbook. But at the same time, you have to consider that every time you're using someone else's role in your playbook, you're relying on them to maintain it, keep it updated, fix bugs and errors, and so on. And there's always a risk that one day, the person making those roles will abandon them, leaving you with a non-functional project and a huge amount of technical debt. People like Jeff are very much some random person in Nebraska from that XKCD strip. That being said, using other people's roles can be pretty helpful, as long as you don't overdo it and also understand all the risks. So coming back to Docker, in order to install Docker on our target host, I'm going to be using Jeff's Docker role. To import the role, I'm going to create a file called requirements.yml and then add these lines to it. Roles, colon, dash name, colon, geerlingguy.docker. We're also going to need the geerlingguy.pip role so that we can manage Docker containers using Ansible. You can get the exact names of the roles by searching them on the Ansible Galaxy website. and then we can install the roles by typing Ansible Galaxy install-r requirements.yml. Many roles provide customizable variables that you can set in your vars files, and Jeff's Docker role already comes with some pretty sane defaults. However, I personally had to add these two lines to make the playbook work on my install of Ubuntu Server 22.04. We also need to add this variable to the pip role. This will install the Docker package for Python on our target host, so that we can manage Docker containers using Ansible. Finally, we need to add both roles to our run.yml. For that, I'm going to use the same syntax that I use for our own role. And at this point, we're pretty much done, so let's execute our playbook. Now we can log into our server, and let's try running the Hello World container. It works! So now we have a working Docker host with our user, which has the correct shell and all the correct groups. We've also hardened our SSH configuration, and while we were doing all that, we also learned about loops, handlers, and Ansible Galaxy. Now, Ansible is a very versatile and powerful tool to manage your servers. But the good news is, you don't need to become an Ansible wizard to create a website for your business, thanks to today's sponsor, Squarespace. Squarespace lets you easily create a website or an online shop for your business. They feature tons of easy and customizable templates for all kinds of websites, from big online stores to small local businesses, as well as personal blogs, CVs, and portfolios. Squarespace also features 24/7 support and a variety of tools to help you grow your online presence, such as domain management, SEO marketing, and so on. Go to squarespace.com for a free trial. And when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/wolfgang to save 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain. So thank you Squarespace for sponsoring this video, and also a big thanks to my patrons. Mitchell Valentino, James Uppington, Jubastica, Carlos Bonilla, David Love, Robots Dream of Crypto, Primus, Remus Ilyesh, and everyone else supports this channel. Thank you guys for watching, and I'll see you in the next one. Goodbye.